So, hello everyone. Welcome to semester 4 edition or 2023 edition of So, welcome to the 2023 summer edition of MacLab Talks. This is our first talk of this semester, and it will be a lecture series given by Sagar Ghosh from MA second year, and it will be on functional analysis and partial differential equations. Today is the first talk. We will talk about different kind of topological vector spaces, Banach spaces, Hilbert spaces, and some applications. Over to you, Sagar.
Thank you very much for introducing, and just a little bit action. I won't be talking about PDE, that would be too heavy for you. So that would be only functional analysis. So roughly speaking, in functional analysis we deal with analytic properties of function spaces. So those are very vague words, but roughly what do you mean by function spaces? Is that I can just give you a few examples. It can be very simple and familiar, like R, C, Rn.
Sorry for interrupting, can you write a little bit bigger?
Bigger?
A little bit bigger. Very nice.
Is this fine?
This is fine.
Like it can be R, C, Rn, Cn, it can be R omega with uniform controls. Those who are not familiar with topology, don't worry about the terms. Or C omega, similarly. Or it can be quite complicated, like I am writing a term, don't worry about this, and you can see. I'm just giving you an example. This is known as the operator catalog of all smooth distributions on C, and that can be identified in T times C with the image. It's called the Hilbert space of all. Distributions on C when A is a complex separable vector space. I will talk about this at the very end.
What is the distribution?
Oh, better than another half an hour story. I'm just writing this just to give you an introduction of function spaces. Distributions are, you can think of it as some elementary functions in C. It has some regularity on it as well. You will set to be a distribution in. So the analytic properties by I mean it might be finding the complex set of invariants for some linear operators. Like in spectrum spectra, you know, finite-dimensional normal operator can be scattered and sparse set of eigenvalues and their multiplicities. considered safe sample. It might be solving some partial differential equation. Might be solving some variational problems in calculus. I will talk about this later at the very beginning for calculations. These are just examples. So, if you have you need a general setup where you talk about some probability or algebra. Like in algebra, you need group theory, you need a set, you need some operations on it. Then rings and fields and modules, you need certain kind of operations on the set. In probability, you need a set, you need a signal probability, and you have a set map probability from omega to r plus. Satisfy certain axioms. Similarly, in functional analysis, we need a setup. So, in this setup, we have the function spaces, that is, this kind of sets. We import certain structures. The first one is topological structure. The second one is algebraic. Solve the average problems. By using the structures. While we impose these two structures, we impose them independently. But you will see shortly that there is a way to interpret these two. There is a connection. We'll correlate these two so that we can get the maximum out of it. Not in the probability sense. So before that, I would like to talk about a little bit of grad and topology because I am quite often using these things. So you have a set X. You have a collection term of subsets of X. Satisfying. The following three properties. The empty set and X belong to the collection term. In U lambda for some indexing set U lambda belong to the collection term. Then there are arbitrary here. Also belong to the collection. The third one is if V1 and V2 belong to ground, then V1 intersection V2 belongs to ground. Or you say transfinite induction, you can say that it's tau is close at a finite intersection. here tau is close and arbitrary. Like for example, you know, you are familiar with real analysis, so I can generalize and say, so for certain set, positive of the units, and if I know this, x. Take this. We write the topology on x as the exponent of this product. Okay. Second one is basis for the so you have a double analysis of states. So this is for a topology of X is the collection of subsets of X. That's fine. X there exists an element Bx in the collection. So the X is in the X. The second one is if X belongs to two such elements B1 and B2, then there is a third element B3 in the collection, so that X belongs to B3 or getting B1 intersection. Now I can introduce the topology of R. You are familiar with open sets and closed sets.
Yeah.
So in R, the usual topology that is said by the set of all elements of the form A equal to B. A less than B. A is greater than B is the same thing. So we don't need this condition. It is arbitrary. Since I have mentioned that this defines a topology of R, so given a basis, there is a way to go into topology, and given a topology, there is a way to go into basis. stating the results I want to build. So if you have a topological space, take some. Let scripts be the collection. The elements of tau are called open sets. This is a collection of all open sets. For any U in tau, that is any open set in the collection tau, and any X in U, there is an element C in script C. So that X is in C, which is not in A. Then C is the basis. This is from the topology given. We are going to basis. The second method is opposite. When you have a system, so X is there. So it was this.
The topology tau. Sorry, one second. Can you write a little bit bigger? It's not coming. I mean, in general, everything. It's okay till now. After this,
then tau equals the collection. All areas of the dimension. So this is the basis. You can go into the language. So the next part would be a definition. That would be the definition of continuity. The function A, power to the stress X now. Tau x, tau over the base y, tau y. We said to be continuous. For all open sets, P in the topology of y. Inversely, university is opening the website, the university belongs to nowadays. So you can you can correlate this with your known epsilon delta definition of continuity or R. This is the result that I will lead you to check. This is the bigger function, the most generalized function, the definition of function. And you are familiar with vector space, right?
Yeah.
Then I can now talk about vector space. This will impose two structures, one is the domain construction and the other is the structural construction. So this motivates the definition of the domain construction. This is similar to the definition of the domain construction group of fluids and grains, what you can think of. So the idea is so you have a domain space X and X is already a vector space. Then X is said to be a topological vector space. And the scalar alpha. The scalar field on which the vector space is based on these operations are continuous. This means given W, given local set W around X plus 1. There is U1 around X and U2 around Y. So the U1 plus U2 is not in W. So U1 plus U2 is the set wise addition of all the things. So U1 plus U2 that is A plus B. And this one can imply given W around alpha X, there exists U containing X and a part greater than zero, such that beta u is contained in w for all beta in the scalar field form, such that mod of beta minus alpha is less than 1. So in most of the cases, our scalar field will be R or C. Or Rn or C. But if it's Rn or C, it further goes up to R. So I can take the modulus and divide this.
So when we impose this, these two properties, are we essentially trying to abstract out that we want our operators on this space to be continuous?
What is the operator on this
space? No, so any arbitrary operator that we define on this space, we want that to be continuous.
No, it's not necessary. It's just that two operators are can be some unbounded operator. I will talk about this property later. You will see that the operator on this topological vector space will be continuous if and only if it's bounded in a local level of zero. There are characteristics of this operator. It is not continuous then. Like on R greater than 0. But there are ways of this. What is the last statement? The last statement is okay. Is this intuitive?
Yeah.
Okay. So I write this that alpha over x, alpha is a scalar, that goes to alpha dot x. This is continuous, that means if you are given an open set W which contains alpha x, then there exists P and open set containing x and a real number r greater than 0, such that beta V containing W for all beta in the scalar field phi, so that mod of beta minus alpha is less than r. That's similar to the condition of the first case. Like this is an open set of open ball of radius r around the set around alpha. Like you have alpha, you are taking out an open ball of radius r. This is your open set, and beta b, by I mean that beta is acting on all the elements on b. So this is an open set, and this continuity. This is the definition of continuity for scalar multiplication. This clear? X tau x and another topological says y tau y. In that if from x to y is said to be a homeomorphism, budget bill. It is continuous in the nominal sense that I already defined. And if inverse, because it is logically if inverse is defined, if inverse is also continuous. And in that case, x is said to be homeomorphic to 1. Should be positive, y to be also absolutely positive. The topology has sent the usual topology on R. And take the function f to be. This is bijective. It's not in our side, it's also in our for lambda non zero. This is one of the options. This is an easy check. I think you can do it. This is of course continuous by the definition of the local vectors. This is invertible because the inverse is x minus n. Inverse is also continuous. This is continuous. Everything also similar. The case is almost similar to that. This is the second thing. This is also continuous under scalar multiplication. But there is a caution that I will talk about later. Although it is a homeomorphism, its translation does not preserve the Banach fixed point theorem. also looks that looks quite highly non-trivial. Not quite. Although this looks like this is indeed a volume of the plant that has a built up all the inherent set of differences. Now I am in position to defend the local. So this is the definition of the from an ordinary topological set or ordinary topological sets to a topological vector space. Because you have the additive structures on the topological vector space, you can translate everything to zero. And then define the base around zero and then again translate it to define an open set around the point. So what I say is that, what I'm trying to say is that if you have a point X here, if you want to define some open sets around that point, to translate X to zero, then define an open set around zero, then translate it back to X, you will get an open set around X. This is what I mean by topological. There is another criterion. So this is a collection of open sets around zero, such that every neighborhood around zero contains some elements of it, contains at least one. The topology on a vector space, we call it a vector topology. Every vector topology is translational. This is also a statement of the fact that it is a volume of this. Series of definitions. So you are already familiar. this point, once you get habituated with this set addition and multiplication, set B, you have a point x, it means the entire line from x to minus x is inside B. That is what is made of that. Say a metric B on X to the ingredient, particularly translated ingredient. If B of X plus Z, Y plus Z equals B of X, Y. For all x, y, z, x. It's a big quotient while find x will be metrizable. A couple of them the first one will be metrizable or not. But if it has a metric B, then we call it translation invariant. If results are distance under translation. These are whose members are convex. X is said to be bounded if for any local level of This, well, this local lemma will always exist because everything you can translate it to C. For any W around 0, there exists some elements say R less than 0, thus that Y is contained in TW for all T greater than R. That means a set is every bounded. Any small level of zero, the scale is sufficiently large. It will be contained in the set of set of vectors of one dimension. Scale set of a certain scale. That's what is being bounded. The sixth one is the local bounded set. That is same as local bounded set. It has a localness, which is on the appearance of the next time we talk about some separation axioms of topology. Locally bounded set is always bounded here. That's the definition of boundedness.
Locally bounded means that if we open it around 0, there is bounded set.
No. It admits a localness which is projected in this form. That's why I said it's similar. It admits a localness.
The entire topological space is called locally bounded if it admits a local base, each of whose elements is bounded.
No, 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 a subset of the entire space is bounded.
No, sorry, I don't
get it. The definition of bounded set is a subset of the entire space is bounded.
Yes, so what is the locally bounded set? Locally bounded topological space. Topological the vector space is called locally bounded.
Ah, right.
If
yeah,
it has a basis, each of the elements is
bounded.
Local basis.
I should have written it locally bounded.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Next. Like the topological space extra is said to be Hausdorff. For all x not equal to y in x, there exists two open sets ux for many x and uy for many y. So that ux intersection uy is there. The second one is regular spaces. Similarly, x of p is said to be regular. Any x in x and closed set C descend from X. There exists UX containing X and UC containing the entire set C. Does that UX intersection UC is in the Hausdorff mesh we assume that every singleton set is closed. Some people assume it, some people don't, but I don't want to go into the controversy, so that's why I assume that every singleton set in X is closed. So clearly you can see regularity means Hausdorff, but not the other. The third one is normal spaces. X tau is a topological space whose every single term is closed. If any two descent closed sets, you can separate it. C and D are two closed sets. Descent closed sets. The intersection B is empty. Then D there is UC and UB, UC contains C and UB contains B from H B. So UC intersection UB is going to be. Similarly, normality also will also influence the variability, but this one doesn't. So we are going to be shortly seeing some examples. The past main lesson now will derive on the topological vector space, and every topological vector space is reduced. We have a compact section. And you have a closed set C. So the K intersection C is empty. There is a local neighborhood V of a quadratic zero, so that K plus D intersection C plus B is empty. I just mean that if the open format admits a finite sum, I don't need to define it. Where's the proof? So in the proof, we will prove a proposition. That is every. Zero set B with X, open set P and O zero with X, is set to the same if D equals to minus That means if small p is infinity, then that also becomes minus p is infinity. That alpha p is 0. So it's a negative in the set progression. So if you have
also, here, addition means term by term addition.
Any V1 and V2. V, V, U plus V means this is a set of all U plus V. U is in U, V is in V. All that. So without loss of gravity we can assume k is non-empty. Because k is empty, there is nothing to do, k plus v is automatically empty, so this will backwards satisfy this condition. So we will take a point x in k and x does not belong to c. So there exists a neighborhood V of 0 plus x plus V intersection C is L. This is just a closed function of C. This is the closed function. Now this P contains a symmetric neighbor. So let's call it P. Oh, okay. Yeah. I have to mention one more thing. So from this condition, we have P plus q isn't v, right? Can I write it? This also implies replacing u by part of this kind of a symmetric derivative. U also contains a symmetric derivative. Let's call it u prime. So these three coordinates are symmetric over. So we take this u prime as say a px. So coordinates are symmetric over. That it has x plus vx plus dx plus vx plus vx. That intersection C is empty. But we also have x plus vx plus dx plus vx plus 0. That is. So x plus dx plus dx plus dx intersection C is empty. Now, since dx is a symmetric derivative, we can simply translate it to here. That implies x plus dx plus dx intersection C plus dx.
Is it C minus?
Oh,
no,
it's
symmetric.
It doesn't have a symmetry. Last time is clear to everyone. Shall I do it? You can simply check by taking if the intersection is not empty, take some y here and take some y in both of the steps. So you can get this one. You can get some y. And you have to use this way to see your thing. Yes. So now you just have all back to yourself, okay? There it is, points, it's one, it's same. Okay. That's symmetric neighborhoods. Here is one, up to here is same. Like we have constructed here. K is contained in x1 plus x1 symmetric local neighborhoods. Of course, we have to do this in my terms. that implies k plus p, if we add p, this addition is distributive over the similar and intersect. So I will replicate n copies of p inside each of the numbers. This is open because of the final intersection token. So that implies k plus p belongs to the area of I runs from 1 to n xi plus kxi plus p. This is fine. I just integrated the entrance inside each of the elements. Now we got the thing. So, that is also contradictory from 1 to n. Xi plus Vxi plus Vxi. Therefore, this intersection is empty because if there is something in the intersection, then it would be one of the elements here. So, if the addition of y belongs to c plus p, intersection a plus p, then y would belong to c plus pxm or all z. Because what is C plus P? C plus P is such intersection I runs from 1 to n C plus P is P is. And why also belongs to K plus P? That implies there is some, say, F. K plus P is contained in this. Xi plus Xi plus P is M plus P is M. But this is true for all J. So Y belongs to XL plus PXL plus PXL intersection C plus PX. That's a contradiction because we have constructed this. That finishes the proof of the idea.
Can we use the closure of this?
Oh, yeah. So that implies from this definition, you can see that this is a regular space because every singleton set is compact. Just K as a singleton and C as a diameter, it is a closed set. So you see that every regular definition space is in a regular space. So of course, it's a Hausdorff space. And I was expecting a question.
Counter example for model.
What will happen if I discuss K by any arbitrary closed set? This is a highly confident example.
when do you use the compact one?
Yeah, the finite. The finite. Next topic, how about the main thing? So, that serves a lot of purposes. It's essentially a very important space for the topologists. It's also an example of a space which is regular but not normal. It's also an example of a space, topological vector space, which is not recursive. Let's first define RL. This is R with a duality. That means the topology is generated by all sets of the form closed and open. That's why it's called duality. I including the duality. These are closed sets. You can separate it out by certain sets or some arbitrary union of these other sets. But so it's a regular space, it's also a first order space. But if I take the Cartesian product of 2RL to RL2, that is RL2, this is known as the Sorten field plane. This is not normal. The proof is also not trivial. So it serves a lot of purposes, first of all. While RL2 is in fact a regular space, because product of regular space is also regular. But for normal spaces, it is not true. So this is an example of a regular space. Which is not normal. This is the first thing. The second thing is, this is an example of a normal space. Example of a normal space. Product is not normal. Third thing is, data will show that every topological vector space which has a counting local basis mechanism. So this is an example of a topological vector space, which is not recursive. Fourth one is, as I have said, this is also an example of a does not admit accountable overlays.
So I can prove it, but maybe I can just give you a rough idea to prove that it's not a normal space. That means you can't separate out two. These are closed sets, but some open networks are not in them.
I've been used to 12.
Okay, maybe I'll make up 5 more periods in this. So you have an original space, it's now. You have a subset, y of x. But you find the subset of y. Restricting the open sets on point as P is sent to P. Open in y if p is equal to y intersection u, where u is open in x. It's not normal, is that you concept the cross that. This, let's call it A, this as a subspace of R2 has discrete domain. Discrete domain means it's single domain something. Now you take the points. Take the points A on M. A consists of all points y, minus 1, such that y is rational. And take L minus 2. Both of them are closed. You can't separate them. It's not that it is the this is the comparison that we are talking about. The proof is sort of non-trivial. It's done in markers whenever you try to close it, you see that it's coming. I mean, not the great example, it's there in the exercise with the star marks. It's the video exercise in this. We have starting for any arbitrary closed sets A of N and N minus A, both of them are closed. So probably I forgot the set. Something between 31 to 30. Just have a look. When he has talked about the probability and separation axioms. Since that example is there in progress. Okay, I am done. I have still a lot of stuff to say, but I don't want to do it. Maybe in the next slide. Thank you.
So are there any questions for Shabbat?
Your work, you use all these terms, like all this terminology.
What?
In your work, like your proper research work, how much topology do you actually do? Like, you take all this stuff directly from that.
I require the weak topology of frequency, complete injective tensor with the range.
But are you studying like proper topological properties of it, or you are studying like
operating? No, of course, I don't need everything. I just need what I need to do.
Okay, that's
what I actually need for my work.
Like your research work doesn't involve topological problem.
A lot of topology I use.
No, you use it, but like as a research problem formulated, you are not studying a particular property of the topology.
Yeah. Right. So, yeah, of course, I don't use this one. I just write it down. It has this property, so it will say.
Anything else? Okay then, thank you so much. And the timings for the next session will be informed on the website. Thank you.
You will talk to the same time on this.